Today is the 23rd lecture of Introduction to Biochemistry, and we are going to discuss chemistry and classification of amino acids. In today's class, we are going to discuss the introduction of amino acids, which kind of compounds are called amino acids and how they are different from other groups, and a brief historical background of amino acids. Then we shall see that they are amino acids, they are different kinds of amino acids, and how we can use three letter abbreviation or one letter abbreviation for these compounds. Then we shall have a detailed study of the classification of amino acids. They can be classified various way, and we shall go through them. And the last part of this lecture is about the non-standard amino acids. Let's talk about amino acids. Basically, this is how you can define amino acid, that is the basic monomerical structural unit of proteins. When we say monomer or monomeric unit of proteins, it means that proteins are basically, you can say, polymers. So what are polymers? Polymers are basically, they consist of small repeating units, and these repeating units are called monomers. So in case of proteins, proteins are polymers, while amino acids are monomers. It means that by the repetition of amino acid units, we get proteins that are macromolecules in nature. So how we define amino acids are that these are the basic monomeric structural unit of proteins, and they are organic in nature, and who constitute are two functional groups. Basically. So one of them is the amino group, and the other one is carboxylic acid group. So when we know about amino group is that it is basic in nature because it can give electronic pair, and carboxylic acid is acidic in nature. It can give proton and also can react with a electronic pair. So the compounds having both amino group as well as acidic group, that is carboxylic acid group, we call these compounds as amino acid. And these amino acids basically, if you can see the structure here, like as you see here, that we have the carbon skeleton, and this carbon is basically attached to the four different groups. One of them is carboxyl group, this one is like amino group, and this the other two groups, one of them is the R group and the other fourth group is hydrogen. What we know about R group, that apart from the R group, everything else is the same in all amino acids. But R group is basically, this is what we call side chain. It may contain no carbon, it may contain only hydrogen, but it could be carbon or any other atom apart from the this skeleton. Like it can have a long chain of carbons, or it can have small chain, or whatever the group, it varies from amino acid to amino acid. And when we talk about amino acid, that all amino acid, that is except proline, they have a carboxyl group and amino group and a distinctive side chain bonded to the alpha carbon atom, which varies between the 20 different amino acid. Basically, by varying this R group, we get a range. Alright, talking about amino acid, there are few things that are very when we talk about the introduction of amino acids, then we already said that proteins are basically polymers of amino acid, and with each amino acid residue joined to its neighbor by a specific type of covalent bond. When we talk about amino acid residue, it means that when we connect these amino acids, then after condensation and during this process, removal of small water molecules or other type of molecules, it happens, and after that we get that part of the amino acid. So that is connected together, and this type of part is called amino acid residue, because when we talk about the two amino acids are reacting together, and after their reaction a small water molecule lays. So it means that the amino acid structure is not the same as before, so what is left over is called amino acid residue. And the bond formed after the departure or the removal of water, so this type of bond is called peptide bond. So we shall study about these things in detail later, but what you have to remember is that in protein molecules, these amino acid residues are connected together through a specific type of covalent bond, which we call as peptide bond. And these proteins can be broken down to their constituent amino acids by a variety of methods, and there are different methods are available, and right now that's not the main focus here, but you have to remember that these proteins are made from amino acids after the removal of high water, and if you hydrolyze these peptides one, then you can again gain these amino acids from protein molecules. And you have to remember this thing that there are total like 20 different amino acids that are commonly found in proteins, but you can't just limit amino acid to 20 these 20 strains or these 20 types. The first one was discovered was like that we know as asparagine in 1806, and the last of 20 to be found was threonine that was not identified until 1938. And when you talk about the nomenclature of amino acid, basically we have some rules for amino acid nomenclature too, but what you need to know right now is that just like the nomenclature of organic compounds, some compounds or some amino acids have their trivial or common names. So sometimes they are like they are different, you can say customs that how they can be named. Sometimes amino acids are named after their source, and sometimes they are named from the place or from where they are isolated, or you can say that it is possible that they can be named after the their nature or the characteristics of these amino acids. Just like asparagine was first found in asparagus, and then it was named like asparagine, and glutamate was found in wheat gluten. So they are named after their source. Similarly, tyrosine was first isolated from cheese. So its name is derived from the Greek word tyros, means cheese. So, and we know about glycine. Glycine is basically derived from a Greek word glycos that does mean sweet. So these are named because of their sweet taste. These are few examples that how amino acids, they are constituents of proteins, but how they have very important roles. Basically we shall study about the roles of amino acids and roles of protein in details too, but right now you have to understand that why these amino acids are very important, that even they are every, you can see proteins everywhere in your society, well settled, like they are part of your bodies as well as they are part of the living world that is around us. So there is an example of firefly, that is a light produced by firefly. It is the result of reaction involving the protein luciferin and ATP, that is adenosine triphosphate, and the enzyme that catalyzes this reaction is known as luciferase. Luciferase enzyme, these are also proteins, and these proteins are also made up of amino acids in turn. You have to remember the light is basically produced by the reaction of a protein and adenosine triphosphate molecule. And similarly, we talk about the erythrocytes, that they contain large amount of oxygen transporting protein hemoglobin. And the third example here is that we know about rhinoceros, that is rhinoceros, they are almost extinct from the world because of their they are extremely, you can say they are widely focused, or you can say widely victimized because of their horns. Their horns are used to make jewelries and also ornamental purposes, but basically it's a myth, or you can say there is a belief in some parts of the world that a powder derived from its horn has aphrodisiac properties. Basically aphrodisiac relates to the something that stimulates the sexual desire in some living organism. So if you talk about it, the real thing, that the chemical properties of powdered rhinoceros horn, they are no different from those of the powdered bovine hooves or human fingernails. Basically these things, like we say that these horns, they are all, or even fingernails, they are all made up of protein we know as keratin. So they are, these horns are not different from the other fingernails or the hooves of other animals. So but they, because of the myth, they are falsely, you can say that it is very wrong to just hunt these rhinoceros for their horns. So right now in many countries this is strictly like they have the government has banned to hunt these animals, but still it's like illegally it is still going on. Let's talk about the history of amino acids, that how these amino acids got discovered or isolated from different proteins or different living organisms. So when we talk about amino acids, then the first amino acids that we discuss in the introduction of amino acid, the first amino acid discovered or isolated was asparagine. It was discovered in 1806 by Perry Jean Robicot and Louis Nicholas from the asparagus juice. Asparagus is basically a vegetable that is very commonly used as in the salad, and it is boiled, and also it is used in the like in different raw and also in the like cooked form too. Secondly, the second amino acid, that is leucine, it was discovered from cheese. And then the third one was in, discovered or isolated in 1820 was glycine from gelatin by acid hydrolysis. So you have to remember the dates and also the amino acids and their sources. So it's better if you make a list of these, the discovery, the year, their source and the name, and make a list of these amino acids. Basically, for an assignment, I have given you the same task, that you have to make a descriptive note on the history of how these amino acids they got isolated from different sources. Okay, so in today's lecture, you have lots of things to learn and remember. If you go through the lecture, you may think that there are lots of things, but actually just there are 20 amino acid names and their structures. So once you have a clear picture of what are these amino acids and their structure, then their classification or their abbreviation is nothing for you. So I strongly suggest that you remember the amino acids name and their structures, and then the letter abbreviation, three letter abbreviation, is not difficult for you, because if you have a closer look on the that how these amino acids got abbreviated, then from the alanine, the three letter abbreviation is ALA. So these are just the first three letters, and in most of the cases the first three letters are used as a three letter abbreviation. And three letter abbreviation is very helpful, because sometimes we don't have to write, and most of the time rather, we don't have to write the whole amino acid name, and rather we just use the three letter abbreviation of these letter. So any amino acid, just like methionine, you have this abbreviation as MET, and sometimes one letter abbreviation is also used. So you can just have a look on these amino acids, and then it will be easier for you to follow when you talk about different proteins or the synthesis of different proteins, or that how these different amino acids are connected together. Now we shall discuss the classification of amino acids. That there are basically different ways how we by which we can classify amino acids, starting from the differences on the side chain structure. Just like we have discussed before, that side chains are the main difference between the structure of amino acids. So the next thing is that is based on the nutritional requirement, and the third part is about the that is based on the structural structure of these amino acids. The fourth one is based on the metabolic fate. This is not fat, this is basically metabolic fate. From now on, you can easily remember the structure of these amino acids. So basically, they are, when you classify amino acid based on the R group, like you vary the R group, just like in, if you remember the structure of amino acid, then with one carbon atom, there are four different groups are attached. If you just look at the, like here we have the first amino acid, that is glycine, that is the simplest amino acid here. So in case of glycine, what you have, there are three different groups that are attached with the carbon, and these three groups are basically, this is the basic part, the structure of the amino acid, and the part that is you can say that highlighted pink by pink color. So with this color is basically we designate or denote denote R group here. So this R group is basically highlighted by the color here. So this glycine is the simplest amino acid here, and by varying this R group, we can we change from glycine to alanine. Just like in alanine, this R group is basically CH3. So based on this R group, we have five different categories of these amino acids. One of them is non-polar aliphatic R groups. The second one is aromatic R group. The third one is negatively charged R group. Let's talk about these three R group, like these three categories first. If you talk about non-polar aliphatic R groups, it means that we have one like R group is basically non-polar here. So basically, in this part, we have alkyl chain here. Like in glycine, this alkyl chain is there is no carbon here, but only hydrogen. And in case of alanine, we have CH3. In proline, we have cyclic structure basically. But there are three carbons that are part of this cyclic structure. And in valine, we have isopropyl unit. And in case of leucine, we have isobutyl unit. And then we have isoleucine, where we have a butyl unit that is like it is connected to the second carbon atom. And in case of methionine, we have a sulfide basically. It's a alkyl group that does contain sulfide group. And in case of and the second categories of aromatic R group, in these amino acids we have R groups that contain benzene are the aromatic compounds. In one case it is phenyl alanine that has benzyl group. In tyrosine it does have phenyl type of like you have phenol type of group attached to it. And then we have tryptophan, and tryptophan indole is attached with the CH2 group here. So these are the two categories that are based on aliphatic or the aromatic R groups. And when we talk about the negatively charged R group, basically if you see the structure of aspartate, basically in this amino acid, if you see the amino acids are basically present in the like zwitterione, that carboxyl group that loses its proton and amino acid accept protons. So these are already in the ionic form or the zwitterione form. Zwitterione is basically that has positive and negative ions together. We are talking about aspartate here, that it does have this R group where carboxyl group is present, but this carboxyl group tends to leave its proton and stays in the negative form. So this is basically negatively charged group. And when we talk about glutamate, and glutamate also has this carboxyl group, but it is attached with the alkyl part here. So the glutamate has, and these are rest of the two categories. That is, one of them is like where R group was just like when R group was negatively charged, and here is R group is positively charged. And then in case where R group is positively charged, then there is a group responsible for that, just like in amino group we see that. So in this case, in one case we have four carbon chain, and then there is a NH2 group that is protonated, so that is known as lysine. So lysine is positively charged with R group. And in arginine we have two NH2 groups basically, but one of them is protonated. So this is arginine, that belongs to positively charged R groups category. And the third one is histidine. Histidine also has this NH group that can be protonated here. So these three belong to the positively charged R group. And when we talk about the polar uncharged R group, then they are serine. In case when we have hydroxymethylene unit attached, and threonine, there is also hydroxyl group that is polar. And cysteine, this because of SH group present. And then in aspargine, we have this amide group is present. And in glutamine, another amide group is present, but this is a homolog of aspargine. Let's talk about the next classification, that is based on the nutritional requirement. Okay, basically these amino acids, they are divided on the basis of which amino acids are required by human body or not, like by the living organism or not. Just like when we talk about essential or indispensable amino acids, then we say that essential amino acids are those that our body that are very essential for us to be supplied from the diet. Like our body cannot make some amino acids, so that's why we have to take this amino acid in our diet. So that's why these amino acids are called essential or indispensable amino acids. And basically these amino acids are like we have isoleucine, leucine here, and then we call it as then we have lysine here, and then methionine here, and also phenylalanine is here, and then tryptophan is here, valine is here, and what is left, I guess these are all, and arginine is, sometimes basically arginine and histidine, they are said to be like essential amino acid, or they are categorized with essential amino acid, but basically these are said to be semi-essential amino acid. Why? Because sometimes like we in our body, like human body, it can synthesize histidine and arginine too, but under circumstances we need to consume them in our diet. That's why they are called semi-essential amino acids. And the rest of the amino acids that our human body can make, and they are not essential for a human to consume in diet, so these amino acids are called non-essential amino acids. As we know that there are total 20 amino acids, so we know that these like the remaining 10 are known as to be non-essential. Then we have another way by which we can classify amino acid based on the structure. These amino acids are basically categorized in these categories. The one of them is aliphatic amino acid, the other one is aromatic amino acid, the third one is heterocyclic amino acid, fourth one is amino acids, and the fifth one is like derived amino acids. When we talk about the first classification, like first category of these amino acid based on the structure, then we say that aliphatic amino acids are basically, they can be divided into two subcategories. One of them is mono amino dicarboxylic acid, and the second one is dibasic monocarboxylic acid. It means that we have two categories, like in one case apart from the basic amino acid skeleton, that is here we have this basic skeleton, and with this skeleton if we have mono like amino and dicarboxylic acid group, then it means that this amino acid is one, but there are two carboxyl groups, then we say this belong to mono amino dicarboxylic acid group. So there are two amino acids that come under this category. One of them is aspartate and the other one is glutamate. You can say if there is H here, then we call it as aspartic acid, and this is also called glutamic acid if there is H present here. And the second category is the one where we have two basic units and one carboxyl unit, just like we have one amino and one carboxyl group, that is the basic part. But if there is one additional amino group that is present in the R group, then we say that this is dibasic group. And then we have one carboxyl group, that is the carboxylic acid form is here, but this is one in number, so we say that these two amino acids, they belong to dibasic monocarboxylic acid group. And the interesting thing is that there are two amino acids that come in under this category. We were talking about aliphatic amino acids, then we said basically these aliphatic amino acids, they can be classified into three broad categories. One of them is mono amino monocarboxylic acid. The second and third we have already discussed. They were dibasic monocarboxylic acid, are the mono basic and dicarboxylic acid group. So apart from those two categories that we already discussed, the third one is mono amino monocarboxylic acid group. When we talk about mono amino and monocarboxylic acid group, then this subcategory can be further divided into five groups, and these five groups are simple amino acid, branched chain amino acid, hydroxy amino acid, sulfur containing amino acid, and amino acid with amide group. And as the name suggests, these are just, we are talking about the structural classification. So if you talk about the branched chain, it means that it does have an alkyl group, that is branched chain. And we talk about hydroxy amino acid, it should contain hydroxyl group in there. So we shall see the structural that how they are different from each other in the next. And this is how what we call as branched chain amino acids. There are three amino acids that come under this category. One of them is valine, the other is leucine, and the third one is isoleucine. As you can see that they have branched chain alkyl group, that is present as a side chain here. And when we talk about OH group containing amino acid, then they are serine and threonine. And serine, there is CH2OH group, and in threonine there is CHOHCH3 group. So it means that OH containing amino acids are there. And the third category is sulfur containing. One of them contains the thiol, and the other one has a disulfide, that is sulfide group present in there. And then when we talk about or you can say that the third, the second one, that is methionine, is basically sulfide ether. Okay, we have discussed so far the aliphatic amino acids that are based on the structure. The second and the third category is aromatic amino acid, heterocyclic amino acid. Aromatic amino acid we have discussed before too, that these are phenylalanine and tyrosine. And in case of heterocyclic amino acid, we know that indole is aromatic. So this tryptophan is basically heterocyclic amino acid, and there is histidine also present where they are diazo type of, like diazole basically, diazole type of heterocycle is present. And the third, fourth category is the amino acid proline. When we talk about amino acid, it means that it has a rotationally constrained rigid ring type structure, and it has it reduces structural flexibility of polypeptide, for example collagen. And the proline has this structure, that is amino acid base structure. Why we have called it as amino acid? Because here, if you see that this NH2, that was part of the basic structure of these amino acid, that is not free here. So this NH, basically there is NH present, and this NH is basically, if you talk about this NH group, NH2 positive, then this group is basically bridged between these two carbon atoms. That's why we call it as amino acid. And the fifth and last category of these amino acid structural unit is that they are derived amino acid. It means that these amino acids are basically not the original amino acid, like we have proline here. But if you derive another amino acid from this proline amino acid, then we call it, is this a derivative of these two 20 amino acid. So this is what we call as derived amino acid. So one category belongs to the, like one category includes amino acid that are present in protein. Just like we know, the structure written here is 4-hydroxyproline. That is, there is a hydroxy group present on the fourth position, and the other one is 5-hydroxylysine. So there is a hydroxyl group present, that is in addition to the original structure of lysine. So basically, these derived amino acids that may be present in protein or may not be present. So one category includes these amino acids that are present in protein. And the next category of these derived amino acids is that are not part of the protein structure, and they are intermediates in certain biosynthetic ways, like intermediate in urea synthesis, because urea is produced in human body, and also there are intermediates in cysteine biosynthesis. So biosynthesis is something going on in living organism. So these are the three like amino acids, that is ornithine and citrulline and homocysteine. Why we call these as amino acid? Because the basic structural unit, if you see here, then this carbon is basically attached to carboxyl group NH2 and hydrogen, as well as an alkyl part. So we call it as amino acid, but this one is not, that is, it is not present in proteins. So what we call as, these are derived amino acids, but these are not found in proteins. So there are three examples of these proteins, these amino acids. And the next category is like non-alpha amino acids. It means that normally what we say, that if we call that there is a central carbon atom which is attached to NH3 positive and COO negative, we call it as alpha amino acid, because there is, here we have an alkyl group. So we call it as L-alpha-alanine. L is basically depending, it depends upon the stereochemistry. And when we talk about beta-alanine, it means that there is, this NH2 group is not present on the alpha carbon. How we designate alpha position? Because if you talk about the main, the most priority is given to carboxyl group in the nomenclature. So the next carbon next to carboxyl group is alpha carbon, and the next carbon is called beta carbon. If NH2 is present on the alpha carbon, we call it as alpha-alanine. And then if NH2 group is present on the beta carbon, we call it as beta-alanine. Alanine is basically an amino acid. Most of these 20 amino acids that we have studied so far, they are all alpha amino acid. But there are also non-alpha amino acid present, just like beta alanine and beta amino butyric acid shown here. So in beta amino acid, what's in there? That NH2 shift its position from the alpha to beta position. Just like if the regular alanine structure is written, that is alpha alanine. If you talk about beta alanine, that means that NH2 is present on beta carbon. And when we talk about beta amino butyric acid, it means that alpha, beta, and then here gamma position is there. So it means that this is gamma amino butyric acid. Next, we come to the classification of amino acid based on metabolic fate. So these are, there are three categories. Basically, there are two main categories. One of them is like purely ketogenic. The second one is called purely glycogenic. So this is the metabolic fate. It means that if we degrade amino acids to the compounds, and these can be used to generate the ketone bodies. So ketogenic has something to do with the ketone bodies. If the amino acid can be degraded to the ketone bodies, we call these as purely ketogenic. Just like leucine and lysine is sometimes also considered as ketogenic. When we talk about glucogenic means that these amino acids are degraded to compounds. They can be used as carbon skeleton for glucose synthesis by gluconeogenesis. So it means that these are two types, and when we talk about ketogenic and glucogenic, then there are several amino acids that are classified as both glucogenic and ketogenic because of their degradation products. So their examples are also there.